as you walked down the street, you had to look down and not up with eye contact for folks. You went into the stores to buy things and you could hold them up, but they couldn't touch your body. You know, you'd contaminate the clothes with your black body.
I went to Antioch University and then I worked in a factory because that was all that I could get. They were very, very prejudiced in Massachusetts at that time.
I knew of people who disappeared. That's what we used to call them, whether they ran away or whether they were hurt or injured. People will never know, and that's why when you talk about the red clay of Mississippi, it's not just red because of the clay.
Everybody is guaranteed life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. You can't be happy if you're hungry. You cannot be happy if you're broke. You cannot be happy if you're stupid. You cannot be happy if you have training and can't use it.
I believe that race is still the biggest domestic issue in this country. And I believe that if the Urban League did not exist today, we'd have to invent it. And I believe the Urban League is as American as apple pie and is as necessary now as it was 95 years ago.
George Edmund Haynes and Mrs. Baldwin were the initial founders of the movement. Mr. Haynes was a social worker. Mrs. Baldwin was the widow of a railroad magnate. So she had lots of money, and she really was committed to equal rights and equal opportunity.
In 1918, Dr. Haynes was succeeded by Eugene Kinkle Jones. Under his direction, the League significantly expanded its campaign to crack the barriers to black employment, spurred first by the boom years of the 1920s and then by the desperate years of the Great Depression. Following Mr. Jones, Lester Granger stepped in and found success in securing jobs and opportunities for blacks and continued to fight for the inclusion of African Americans in racist trade and labor unions.
Whitney Young, of course, is legendary, was the leader of the Urban League in the 1960s and a historic figure in the 20th century in the United States.
His interest in people was amazing. He spoke to big churches and little churches. He spoke to big groups and small groups because he enjoyed talking with people. When he got a chance to go to a nursery school, you see down there playing with the babies.
My father had been involved in the National Urban League and was a former chairman. But the good fight was a very different fight back in the 50s and 60s. And it was not common to see a CEO of a Fortune 500 company out in front of a civil rights issue down in Alabama or Georgia or whatever, with the head of the National Urban League running around trying to either raise money or talk about these issues.
Vernon Jordan was the president of the Urban League, and Ron Brown had worked in the National Urban League forever. And Vernon sent him down to head up the Washington Bureau. And he hadn't been there very long when I came on board with him. I can remember sitting in Vernon Jordan's office when he called the president and got him. I mean, these were two men who, working together, had it covered, whatever it was. They knew everybody, they responded to everybody, and it didn't matter what color they were.
In 1982, John Jacob undertook the leadership of the organization. Jacob's signature initiatives included new emphasis on programs to reduce teenage pregnancy and male responsibility, combating crimes in black communities, and increasing voter registration. In 1994, Hugh Price took over the reins of the League at a time when economic change and the attempts of some to roll back the gains African Americans realized since the 1960s made the League's efforts all the more necessary. Price intensified the organization's work in education, youth development, technology, and affirmative action.
We stand on the shoulders are the great leaders of the 1940s, the 1950s, the 60s, the 70s, and the 80s. But in standing on their shoulders, they would say to us, as my father would often say to my brother and I, you gotta be better than I was. It's not enough for you to meet the standard we set. You all and your generation have got to exceed it because you had an opportunity to walk through doors that we didn't have an opportunity to walk through.
The local urban leagues are the heart of the urban league movement. It's not the national office, it's the essence of this movement. It's what happens day to day in every local urban league affiliate.
I started out as a volunteer in the Stamford or the Southwestern Connecticut Urban League. The thing I tell people is, first of all, there's so much to be done, and whoever you support, if it's the National Urban League or the affiliates of the Urban League, your help will be welcomed.
No one serves more African American kids in the after school hours than we do.
I say the Urban League has made a difference in my life because it helps me to understand communication skills, how to be around other people. New Lights is a program in Urban League, and we meet every other Saturday. We learned a lot about African American culture during this year.
Well, the first person I actually met in Urban League was Miss Scott, because she wrote me a letter of recommendation to Clark Atlanta University. And it was one of the best recommendations for school I ever got. And that was for the, that's one of the schools we visited in the spring college tour. I didn't really care about, you know, much. I just wanted to get my diploma, but the Urban League, you know, I met new people like Shamelia and Vicky and Felicia and Kayshawn and Crystal.
The Urban League, like, I don't know, it's like, it's not only that, you know, the support that they gave me, but it's like a lot of other things that just like pushed me to be like the person who I am now. Cause I really think if I didn't go to the Urban League, I probably would have fell out or, you know, did something that I probably didn't want to do and then have end up with a horrible life.
I want an apartment on my own. And so I came here and talked to the manager of the building. She got me Thornett. Thornett is social work at the Urban League, and she helped me get an apartment here. If I have a bad day, she can perk me up real good. She keeps me going. If I didn't have an Urban League, I don't know where I'd be. I might be on the street.
Well, I believe that the American dream is to own a home, to have a piece of property, but in reality, I never thought that I would be able to own a home. I went to a seminar and I got a counselor. It's different when you put your money down on paper than it is when you're talking to someone. And then you really see what you have and what you don't have and where you really could save at. The Urban League and the HVAC program is valuable to me. Well, it was valuable for me because now I own a piece of property. I'm a homeowner, and that means a lot because now I have something I can leave for my kids, you know, of something that they can start with. Let me tell you what my daughter told me. When we moved here, she said, Mommy, I remember, she said, when I used to wake up, I used to hear all this noise, boom, 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 boom. Now when I wake up, I hear the birds singing. Just broke, it just made my heart just melt.
We've got our own affiliates who are the core and the heart and the muscle and the soul of the movement. We've got our governing board, which is our board of trustees. We've got auxiliary groups like the Guild and the Young Professionals.
The Guild is an art.